one of you. I'm glad you are all here. Let's get to it. We're here to talk about a partnership that we are forming with, well, actually, it's more than just a partnership with Medellin. It's a lot more than that. We are actually creating a new Part 3 public entity, and I'll talk a bit more about that. And it comes down to, in essence, increasing the capacity building for better care, healthcare at home. And that's the whole goal of this initiative. So let me start by just talking about the fact that we have an aging population, and this is a little bit, actually it's a lot why we're doing what we're doing. If we look at the last 15 years, we know that the population of New Brunswick has increased by approximately 2%. We also know in the course of those same last 15 years, the population of 65-year-olds and older has increased by 50% compared to 2% for the general population. We also know that in the next 15 years, we estimate that the population, the total general population, will grow about approximately 1%. And we also know, based on those same demographics, that in the next 15 years, the population of 65-year-olds and older will be again increased by 50%. So as you can see, the numbers don't lie. There is a clear indication that there will be a high percentage, a much higher percentage of 65-year-olds and older in our population. We estimate in 20 years that it will be around 26%. More than a quarter of the total population. So because of that, we need to be ready. The good news is having more seniors, let's call them, you know, what they are, seniors at the time, I'll be there eventually. The good news is most of them do live healthy, productive lives, and a lot of them contribute very positively in the society, in their society. And that's good, and we need to celebrate that. And I think there's a lot of good things coming from that. But unfortunately, the reality is also is that the older the population, the more senior the population, the more chances we will see some health issues. So we are expecting a higher intake of emergency room visits, as you can see, and more chronic health conditions, such as, for example, diabetes or hypertension, high blood pressure, mobility issues, things like that. So knowing that we're going to have 50% more seniors living in New Brunswick, that means that, does it mean that we'll have 50% more people with health issues or more? I can't say that for sure, but definitely for sure, we can say that there will be a much higher number. So we need to be ready. So what we want to do here is that we already have three very well-working services that provide care within the homes. And those three services are all currently under the health department, the Department of Health. And they are the ones that you see there, the extramural program, the Telecare 811 service, as well as Ambulance New Brunswick. Ambulance New Brunswick is already what we call a Part 3 public entity. Part 3 means it's actually a part of government structure. And so Part 3 is basically everything, all government structures that are related to health. And in this particular case, that we talk about the RHAs, the regional health authorities, which are Horizon and Vitalité. Those are Part 3 public entities. Ambulance New Brunswick is also a Part 3 public entity, as well as the New Brunswick Health Council, which conducts research and gathers statistics. They are also a Part 3 public entity. And what we're doing now is that we have this service of Ambulance New Brunswick, and for the past 10 years, that service has been a public entity. All the everybody who works within Ambulance New Brunswick is a civil servant, but it has been managed by Medevie for the past 10 years. We also have the 811 telecare service, which you know some of you may have used previously. I know I certainly have. I was given excellent service. That service is actually private already. It is actually a company out of Ontario, Psych Services, that do the management of that service. And we have the extramural program, which are currently under the regional health authorities. And the partnership here is to have all three services within the same Part 3 public entity. So that Part 3 public entity will be called EM for extramural / ANB for Ambulance New Brunswick Inc. And that Part 3 public entity will encompass all three services. And the good news is all those three services, their brand, their respective brands will remain. So even though they're all within one administrative unit, the extramural program will still be the extramural program, Ambulance New Brunswick will still be Ambulance New Brunswick, as well as the Telecare 811 service as well. So we're going to create that Part 3 public entity, so those three companies can work in a more integrated manner. Currently, those three services work independently. Okay, so they work, they do their own thing, and the way it's going to work under the management of Medevie. So the idea here is to have Medevie manage those three services, okay? And they will, it will allow them to work more together. And I'll let Mr. Sandy maybe and Madame Vigneault explain a little bit in more detail what that can entail. But we really feel that it will enhance the quality and care of what patients are given at home. So here's a little bit of the governance model. So as I was explaining, there's the Department of Health, okay, which is ourselves, and under the Department of Health, you will have that board of directors, and that board of directors will be the directors of this Part 3 public entity, okay? And they are the ones responsible for ensuring the proper governance, proper direction of the of all three services, and under that, you see that it's Medevie Health Services that will be subcontracted the management of those services. And those three services, as you can see, will be managed by Medevie, as you can see on that graph. So that's a little bit on how it's going to look like in terms of the governance structure. For us, it's very important that transparency and accountability remain paramount. For the Department of Health, it's important that you know all data is available for the public. We have maintained that, and this will keep on being the case with the creation of this again public entity. And what's interesting with this partnership is that we have some performance-based measures, which we call key performance indicators. And there is I know that in Mr. Sandy's presentation, there is an interesting slide that give out the main key performance indicators. What we want to see in terms of performance. And what's interesting here is we want to see, for example, and I'll spill the beans a little bit here, Mr. Sandy. We want to see, for example, an increase of 15% more visits for the extramural program patients. All the while, and there are other ones that I won't spill the beans, and Mr. Sandy will be able to explain them, but one that is, I feel, is probably the most important one is that the key performance indicator states that the level of quality must be maintained. So, and the level of quality, yes, as you can see with the third bullet here, there is an evaluation framework, and that level of quality is measured by a third party. This is not, it's not the Department of Health, it's not Medivy, it's actually an independent firm that conducts those evaluations. So they can measure the level of satisfaction as they are doing it now. They're doing it for Ambulance New Brunswick, they're doing it for the extramural program already, and they will keep doing it, the same firm or same type of firm, again, completely independent, both from government and from Medivy. And the most important key performance indicator is that that level of quality service or of satisfaction is maintained. And what's important, I feel, with this is that these indicators are linked with financial incentives, okay? So, if they achieve their goals, and again, without compromising the quality and the level of satisfaction, okay, they will obtain financial incentives. If they do not, they receive a whole lot less. I don't know if it's based, I don't have those details. Is it based on percentages, or if they achieve, for example, 50% of the goal, do they get 50% of the incentives? Or those details, I'm not aware, but what I do know is that it is prorated, and they will not, they will only get part of the incentives if they only achieve part of the objectives. And again, I insist, without compromising the level of the quality and level of satisfaction. So that's a bit in a nutshell what is interesting. And one thing I do want to point out, when we talk about another entity, for example, giving this service, well, generally speaking, when you don't achieve your objectives in government, what do government do in general? They say, I'm sorry, I can't achieve my objective, we need more money. And that's pretty much how it works. We need more money. So they come and they ask for more money, for more resources. And that's how it's been basically since governments are governments. In this particular case, what Medivy is saying is, we want to achieve those objectives, but if we don't, do not pay us. And this is all negotiated within the contract. So it's a different thinking, and it allows for, a willingness to see how we can do things differently. And also, again, without compromising the quality and level of satisfaction. Why are we doing this? Well, as I explained about the fact that the population is aging, we need to act now. We cannot wait. I think it would be irresponsible to wait until the problem is here. The best way to act upon something that we know is coming is to prepare in advance. You know I grew up with a wood stove. We wouldn't wait in December to go chop wood and fill the basement full of wood. We'd do it in the summer while the weather was still nice, or in the early fall. And come October, all the wood would be piled and we'd be ready for winter. Well, This is pretty much the same thing here. We know that in 15 years' time, it'll be, I don't want to say winter, because maybe it's not a good analogy, but we'll be in a situation where if we will not have acted previously, we will be in a jam. And that's exactly, and as the Department of Health, as Minister of Health, it is our responsibility to be proactive and to ensure that we are ready for what's coming. So that's why, and also it's about, I'm looking at the slides, I have this whole presentation here, but this is my 8th presentation, so I'm starting to know all of this a little bit by heart. But it's about making what we have now more, let's say, we really just basically want to build capacity. So we're able to do better with what we have. So that's the idea here. And this partnership and this integration will allow that. There's also there's a good example in the schools where there's a new program of integrated services that are targeting school children that have mental health issues. Previously, in the schools, and children who had mental health issues, well, if they had a psychologist or a psychiatrist or a social worker or their teacher or the principal or the parents, well, nobody really knew what the other one was thinking or where they were, or everybody was kind of working in silos. And with this new program of integrated services, everybody will be sitting around the same table. All of those, you know, the school nurse, the psychologist, the psychiatrist, the parents, the principal, they'll all be sitting at the same table and seeing, okay, so what are you doing? What are we doing? What are you doing? So how can we all ensure that we're all rowing in the same direction and making sure that that child gets the best healthcare? There's no duplication. There's no over-medication. So we know that everybody knows what the other person is doing. So it gives a much better targeted, clearer, and efficient and effective treatment for the child. And this is kind of exactly where we're going with this integration as well. So everybody knows what the others are doing and how we can better mesh those together. So it's providing the right care at the right time by the right health care provider. And as you can see, I pressed the wrong button. We feel that there's benefits for the patient where we have those same publicly funded services. Again, this is not, I've heard the word privatization a lot. I'm sure as you have as well. This is, again, a public service that will remain public. Ambulance New Brunswick, it has been for the past 10 years, a public service managed by Medivie. And they'll explain who is Medivie as well. That'll give you a better idea of who they are. And again, as I was talking, greater integration of resources. I also want to talk about the fact that for the healthcare providers, that is also, I think, we see also some benefits. It's important to note that all employees, and I'm talking here specifically, maybe more specifically for the extramural program healthcare providers, all of these people, including everybody, they will remain public employees with all the collective agreements. All of that, of those collective agreements will be respected. All the same benefits, all the same vacations, all the same advantages, all of that. All of that remains as it was previously. So they remain fully public employees. Voila. This is my last slide, so I'm finishing up. Here, what I want to say here is that we really need to look into the future. And we feel that with this partnership, we will have what I would call the best bang for our buck in terms of better capacity to deal with higher volumes with the same level of care, of quality care, that exists now. We all know that Ambulance New Brunswick, somebody was making the remark yesterday, and that I thought it was really, really interesting, because for your information, in the last 10 years, Ambulance New Brunswick does approximately 100,000 calls a year. And that includes also transfer of patients. Okay, so just so you know, full disclosure, it's not always first response. But nonetheless, 100,000 a year. So in the past 10 years, it's basically 1 million calls. Out of those million calls, there has been 21 complaints for language to the language commissioner, and there has been a few complaints for response times. Okay? I don't have the number, but there has been. But let's be honest, out of a million. Okay? And the other thing as well is that we have not heard complaints regarding the quality of the intervention. Might not have been as quick or in the language that we wanted, but it was never a complaint about the service obtained, given by the paramedics. So the reason I bring that up is to say that we have a great service at Ambulance New Brunswick. And we also have a fantastic service with the extramural program. The extramural program is the crown jewel of the healthcare system here in New Brunswick. I was in Edmonton, two and a half weeks ago. I was in Edmonton for a meeting with all the provincial health ministers, and we had a breakfast with the Canadian Union for Nurses, and actually the president of the, the president of the union, or is it the director general? She's a New Brunswicker. And they had done a study regarding home care services. Mostly, it had more of a nursing aspect to it. But they were giving two examples of best practices. And one of those examples of best practices was the extramural program here in New Brunswick. So there's no doubt that this is a fantastic program. And I can assure you that it is our intention here with this partnership to maintain that level of quality service within both Ambulance New Brunswick, in improving them, obviously, and in the extramural program. So that is my commitment, that is our commitment. And if I thought for a second, and I'll conclude with this sentence, if I thought for a second that this initiative would diminish in any way the quality of care to patients in New Brunswick, I would not go ahead. I simply would not. This is about improving the quality of care for home patients in New Brunswick. So I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you, Mr. Minister. Now I would like to introduce Mr. Eric Sandy, President of Medevi Health Services. Eric Sandy's career has spanned a variety of industries, including healthcare, financial services, energy, and communications. He has significant experience and expertise leading high-growth technology and healthcare service companies. He has led Canadian, U.S., and international organizations, turning strategic insight into actionable plans and results. He has joined Medevi Health Services as president in August 2013, where he leads a team of 4,000 healthcare professionals delivering out-of-hospital emergency medical services and primary clinical care across six Canadian provinces. Mr. Sandy.
Thank you, Pierre. Thank you, Minister. And thank you everybody for coming out tonight. This is great to have such a good turnout. It shows the great level of concern and care around our healthcare system. That's a terrific thing. What I want to go through is to tell you a bit about Medivy, because some of you may know something of us, but many of you may not. So I want to talk a little bit about our experience and how we have worked in the healthcare system for many, many years. Then I want to talk about the model itself, the model of integrated care. What are our goals specifically? What are the benefits to the patients of New Brunswick, and how are we going to be held accountable through this entire process? I think I just turned it off. Oh, there we go. So a little bit about Medivy. So Medivy itself, we're a nonprofit organization. We don't have any shareholders. We don't have to provide quarterly dividends to Wall Street, to investors or bankers. Any profits that we do make are reinvested back into the organization to buy new assets, to invest in training, to invest in technology, or we give the money to the Medivy Health Foundation. We'll talk a bit about that in a second. So we have three companies in the Medivy family. The first is Medivy Blue Cross, who many of you may know, maybe policy members. They offer traditional plans through employee benefits programs, individual programs, and then they run some government services. Medivy Blue Cross has been here in New Brunswick for over 70 years. It was started by physicians, nurses, and patients before there was any Medicare, who came together cooperatively to make sure there was insurance for average New Brunswickers for when they or their families met health concerns. Medivy Health Services started 20 years ago, where we were asked to organize the emergency medical services for the province of Nova Scotia. Much like New Brunswick, the province had 50-odd independent ambulance operations. And so we brought them all together into one system. And what we had before was a fractured system where you didn't have any uniform standards on vehicles, on safety, on clinical protocols, on language and service delivery. All of those things were very fragmented, as they were in New Brunswick 10 years ago when we organized the system here. And we were able to create a unified system that was part of the healthcare system that was really here to do two things. One is to deliver emergency services effectively. The second was to work in the community to assist all the healthcare practitioners with all their out-of-hospital duties to make sure the patients were safe and had the best healthcare they could. So we went from Nova Scotia to New Brunswick and Prince Edward Island, and we manage the EMS programs for all three of those provinces. And we're also active in Ontario, Saskatchewan, Alberta, and in Massachusetts. In addition to that, we also run the 811 telehealth programs in Nova Scotia and in Prince Edward Island. We have a training school for paramedics, and we do a number of other things as well. Just to give you a little bit of sense of the scope, we are national in scope. We have operations in eight provinces, although people under Blue Cross health insurance are active in all provinces in Canada. We have about 5,500 professionals working for Medivy through our headquarters in Moncton. About 70-80% of those would be union-based employees, so we have lots of experience working with bargaining units. And we employ everything from paramedics to nurses, dental hygienists, doctors, paramedics, pharmacists, and of course large IT staff and large administrative staff as well. We like to believe that we are bringing those people together to bring real value to patients, to healthcare professionals, and to our government clients. And we are able to innovate in the healthcare space, bringing new solutions like the one we're going to talk about. Our EMS operations cover almost 2.5 million Canadians. As the minister said, we cover 100,000 EMS trips per year in New Brunswick and about 350,000 in total across Canada. So we're very active in the healthcare space. As I also mentioned, we have, I guess, 75 years here in New Brunswick, and we are based in Moncton. Over 2,500 of our employees are here in New Brunswick itself. And we have some very significant operations managing a whole variety of things. One of the things I'd like to point out is we've got one of the largest IT development organizations in the province, where we have over 200 very, very skilled individuals that we've employed in New Brunswick to work on cutting-edge technology. I want to talk a bit about some of our government partnerships. You can see a lot of logos up there. And I want to talk about some of the other outsource opportunities that we've had to work on healthcare across Canada. So on a federal basis, Medivir Blue Cross, first of all, it administers the health benefits and services for Veterans Affairs Canada. We've done that since 1989. We also manage the federal health claims processing system for the Canadian Armed Forces and for the RCMP. And we manage the interim federal health program for refugees that are coming to Canada. Medivir Health Services, in addition, works for the Canadian Armed Forces, training all of the French and English language paramedics that are in the Armed Forces and are posted overseas. On a provincial basis, I mentioned since 1997, we've been running the EMS program in Nova Scotia. We just celebrated our 20th year of that particular contract. We also manage their Medicare program called the MSI program in that province, their workman's compensation program, their PharmaCare, and the prescription monitoring in Nova Scotia. New Brunswick, of course, as mentioned, we've had the ambulance New Brunswick contract and built the system here for the province 10 years ago, so that was in 2007. We also manage the New Brunswick prescription drug program since 1975 and the New Brunswick drug plan since 2014. WorkSafe New Brunswick has also been a client of Medivir Blue Crosses since 2004. I could go on with PEI in Ontario and other provinces. We have a number of other government contracts where they have outsourced healthcare programs to our organization. I want to talk a little bit about some of the innovation that we've had in terms of community health care itself. A lot of this has been based on using paramedics in two ways. One is in rural settings where there may be an extra capacity for paramedics, where during a work day there may be a number of hours that are available for them to go and to work with individuals in their homes. Or in urban settings where it's very busy, we often hire paramedics outside of the emergency setting and put them in non-ambulance vehicles to assist people. So one example would be what we call the Extended Care Paramedic Program, and that's where we have paramedics working in long-term care facilities, about 40 of them in Nova Scotia, Prince Edward Island, and Saskatoon. So they work right in the long-term care facilities and provide health care at bedside for seniors that are having a health issue. This has reduced emergency department visits by 75%, and the other 25% would be what we call facilitated visits, where we can bring someone to a hospital on a scheduled basis so they can be in and out really quickly without having to wait. We have another program that we call the Community Paramedics Improving Patient Outcomes Program. This one is in Ontario, where we've identified the in one particular health region, the 500 individuals who are in and out of ERs and being readmitted to hospitals at the highest frequency. We identify those patients, we get a nurse to build a case management program for them, and then we arrange for nurses and paramedics to visit them in their homes to make sure that they're healthy and comfortable. And that has reduced ER visits and hospital readmissions by over 60%. The last one I want to talk about is palliative care. We're in Nova Scotia and Prince Edward Island. We have trained all the paramedics to deal with pain management and respiratory issues for individuals with palliative care. And we reduced their visits to the hospital by 35%. It's a very new program, so we're hoping those numbers will actually improve. And as you can imagine, the benefits there aren't about necessarily reducing trips into the hospital. It's about providing compassionate care in the home to the individual and the family and giving that comfort right at bedside again. So I could go on. We've got probably 25 different programs like that where we've been able to document with evidence that we are able to assist people more effectively in home by bringing clinical innovation and new protocols to those particular provinces or hospital systems. In our particular model that we're talking about today, about integrating primary health care, as the minister said, we have three outstanding programs in the province. There's Ambulance New Brunswick, the Extramural Program, and 811 Telehealth. All of them are operating at a fairly high level right now, and there is absolutely no critique whatsoever of the quality of service either of them deliver. The value that we're going to deliver is by integrating these programs to create a team-based approach to care for patients in their homes. So I'll give you a hypothetical example, but one we hope to see happening sometime in the next year or so. If somebody phones for 911, let's say they are complaining about a respiratory problem, right now, we have one option, that's to send an ambulance out with lights and sirens to go and visit them. If we can have that call come in and have them interviewed by a nurse, we might understand that in fact it's not an emergency situation. But that person definitely has a respiratory issue. So we will arrange for a paramedic crew to come at a time of their convenience later that day to see how their health is, do an assessment, and make sure they're comfortable. When the paramedics are there, they may do all of that, but then decide, you know what, you really do need a nurse with a higher scope of care to come and visit you. And we will arrange an appointment right now for tomorrow for that nurse to come. In the meantime, we will also arrange for telecare to phone in on you every couple of hours to make sure that you're comfortable and everything's going fine. And we may also install some home monitoring devices, which will look at your vital signs and present that information back to a clinician in the medical triage center. So that's an example where we think that we can bring, in a particular situation, a very, very concrete integrative care plan, whereas in the past, what you might have seen is some of those interactions may have happened, but they certainly wouldn't have been a coordinated approach to that individual's care. You wouldn't have had the communication from one organization to the other, because we don't have that, but we're going to put that in place. So the plan here is to really, by bringing them together, by integrating them, we're going to have an opportunity for those three organizations to act as one for the benefit of the patient to make sure that they are as healthy as possible, and that they can be at home where they're the most comfortable and they can lead the highest quality of life that they can possibly do. So that is essentially how the plan is going to work. And on January 1st, we'll start rolling out the processes that are going to make that available to them. So why should MediVie be allowed or asked to participate in this? Well, we think we've got some significant experience that we talked about. We have a proven track record here in New Brunswick by creating and managing Ambulance New Brunswick and working on some other government systems. We've got strong expertise, as I talked about, in terms of coordinating the logistics of care and providing high quality care in the home itself. Our organization insists on having performance-based contracts. We are not interested in just getting paid a fee to do something. We want to have very strong metrics that we are accountable for to show that we are actually moving the needle and going forward. We do that to drive some modest profitability into the organization. And I forgot to mention early on, when I was talking about our profits and I mentioned we're a nonprofit, those profits go to the MediVie Health Foundation. So that's a foundation we established about 5 years ago. And we put $50 million into that foundation. And it invests in three areas, into diabetes, into child and youth mental health, and in post-traumatic stress disorder. So we have spent about $11 or $12 million over the past few years providing nutrition and diabetes coaches for people afflicted with that chronic illness, helping teenagers that have mental health issues get the treatments that they need immediately instead of having to wait 2 or 3 months to see a psychologist or a psychiatrist. Or working with families who have a loved one with post-traumatic stress disorder, working with the spouses and the children to understand that individual's affliction and how they can manage that at home and help them become healthier and happier individuals. And then we're technology focused. We have a very strong competency in technology, and we think that technology can really add a lot of effectiveness and productivity to the system. It can enhance communication, and it can empower patients by giving them more information about their particular situation so that they can participate in their healthcare if they choose to. In terms of performance assurances, we must comply with the Officials Languages Act. We have for 10 years, that's in our DNA. Not only is it the what we're required to do by law, but it is the right thing to do in this province, and we're dedicated to that. As mentioned by the minister, all the employees will remain employees of the government of New Brunswick through the Part 3 company. We will just manage them. And any questions about the regional delivery of EMP in particular, we can put those aside because we are dedicated to delivering in the regions that we do now, in the facilities that we do now. Healthcare at that level is, of course, a face-to-face operation. And, you know, you can't possibly do that for this entire province or, you know, a number of centralized areas. So we will always have regional facilities in rural New Brunswick. There are a number of benefits to this approach. You know, for patients, we think there would be a much improved patient experience, both for the patient and, importantly, for the family, particularly with seniors or particularly for people with complex chronic illness. It is often very dependent upon the family to help those individuals manage their problems and get to their appointments, and we think that we can bring the healthcare to those individuals and benefit the patient and importantly, the caregivers that are working with them. There'll be fewer emergency visits, there'll be fewer ambulance trips, more care in the community, and of course, improved patient outcomes are the what we're going after here. It's not just comfort, we want people to get better. For healthcare providers, we believe we can offer growth to all the professionals working for us. They'll have a chance to challenge themselves and work a little higher in the scope of their particular practice. We'll give them access to long-promised technology to make their lives easier so they have less administration and more time to work with patients. It's important to know that if there are more patients' visits, it's going to be the same level of quality and the same amount of time it takes to do a good thorough visit. We will not be pushing people to have shortened visits and provide a standard of care that is less than it is today. And there's an opportunity to be more collaborative as well. And for taxpayers, there are synergies and efficiencies in here. There's the opportunity for us to add capacity to the province without additional cost. And we'll talk a bit about that with this next slide, which is about our key performance indicators. So, as I mentioned, the contract that we have with the government of New Brunswick is very specific on how we get rewarded. We can earn, we have an opportunity to earn $1.8 million worth of income. That's based on a bonus plan, and we have five metrics that we have to hit. As we do better and better in those particular metrics, we will get some more reward. If we happen to slip, there are in fact financial penalties for us. So the first metric is going to be time to care. We're dedicated to reducing the time from a request for care in the home to the time that it's actually delivered. We want to move that from 3 days down to 1 day. We're going to reduce the number of visits by extramural patients to the emergency department by giving them better care in the home. We expect that to be reduced by 15%. We really want to have the strong support of the primary care community, so that's specifically physicians and nurse practitioners. We expect to see referrals by them increase by 20%. The EMP visits themselves, we believe we can generate an extra 100,000 visits into the community. That's about a 15% increase in the number of visits to patients in their home. And then patient satisfaction, which is very high right now, it will not slip. It's at 95%. We're in fact going to try and get that higher, but it certainly won't fall below that. All of those measures are going to be measured independently by the New Brunswick Health Quality Council, so that's a third party that will be doing it. We will not be measuring ourselves. And again, if we do not achieve these metrics, we will just simply not get paid. So we are going at risk as an organization because we believe that this model is going to be very effective for New Brunswickers. And as an organization, our mission is to improve the well-being of Canadians. And we think this is a way that we can do that to help transform community care here in New Brunswick. I would also like to add that this is a model that is getting a lot of attention across Canada. Clearly here in the Maritimes, the other provinces are very interested in emulating it. But I spent time with the Minister of Health in Ontario, and he's interested in how this can help him with the 14 million residents of that province. And we've had chats in Western Canada as well that are very, very interested in watching this. Ottawa is also looking at this as a potential model that they would want to use across the country as well. So with that, I will leave it to the Q&A period and pass it along.
Thank you, Mr. Sandy. We also have with us this evening Ms. Marie-José Béliveau, who is part of the extramural program management team, and she will speak to us about the new integrated healthcare approach from that perspective. So, Ms. Béliveau.
Merci bien. Bonsoir. Good evening. I am a nurse by profession. I have been working for the extramural program for the past 20 years, 4 years as a frontline nurse and 16 years as a manager. Tonight, I'm here to tell you why, as a member of the extramural program, I see many benefits in creating more capacity in the front line of New Brunswick's primary healthcare system. We must not forget that the extramural program has a long and proud history in New Brunswick. Extramural staff members are very passionate, devoted, and go above and beyond every day. They are nurses, licensed practical nurses, respiratory therapists, occupational therapists, rehab assistants, physiotherapists, speech-language pathologists, social workers, dietitians, administrative supports, and managers. All these team members are part of what we call the interdisciplinary team at Extramural. EMP Extramural is often called Hospital Without Walls. We provide home health care services to New Brunswickers who have a range of illnesses, injuries, chronic conditions, or palliative care needs. The Extramural program has the mandate to provide an alternative to hospital and nursing home admission, facilitate early discharge from hospital, provide long-term care, palliative care, rehabilitation services, and coordinate support services in the province. My 40-year-old sister, after a courageous battle against breast cancer, had her last wish come true of dying at home, surrounded by her family and loved ones, all because of the care, the support, guidance that she received and we received from the interdisciplinary team at EMP. I am very grateful for this. We recognize that patients and their families have unique challenges and healthcare needs. It's not always easy for the patients or their family to navigate within the medical system. We respond to these needs and work with the patients and their families to develop individualized care plans to support their health challenges. We care for New Brunswickers 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 12 months of the year, 365 days. We never close. We are on the front line and we see the pressures and challenges that are mounting in our province when it comes to providing primary health care services. We've all collectively been aware of the so-called gray wave that has been growing in New Brunswick and across Canada. Our population is aging rapidly, and as New Brunswickers get older, it's no surprise that they often need more support and care, as mentioned by Mr. Burke. Most seniors want to stay at home as independently as possible, despite any health conditions that they may be experiencing. The Extramural program helps them do just that, and we do it very well. My 84-year-old mother, an old nurse, is one of those seniors. In the past year, she's been in the hospital 3 times due to her chronic condition. With the help of the liaison nurse, she received an early discharge and returned home to her apartment to live independently and safely with the ongoing support of Extramural. My colleagues and I pride ourselves in the quality of service we deliver and the relationships we build with our patients and families and loved ones. We have a very high patient satisfaction rate that we are all dedicated to maintaining. But in the face of rapidly aging population, we also recognize that we need more capacity to maintain our standards. We have to look at innovative ways to fully utilize all primary health care resources in New Brunswick to assure that our patients, who are mostly seniors, can get the care they deserve in a timely fashion to allow them to stay at home for as long as possible. We see and live every day patients struggling to manage chronic conditions, adjusting to life with new mobility issues, or receiving endless care in their own home. By better integrating the services of Extramural Program, Ambulance New Brunswick, and Telecare 811, we will create links where links never existed before. We will enable other qualified primary healthcare professionals in our province to help us provide more care to our patients, something that will be extremely beneficial today as well as in the future years, when the pressures on our healthcare system become even greater. For example, telecare nurses, who are often first point of contact for New Brunswickers experiencing an immediate or emerging health issue, will now be able to identify and triage issues and ensure follow-up by Extramural staff if needed. And well, paramedics, who now have mainly focused on emergency response, will now see their scope expanded to include more community paramedicine. an innovative approach that allows paramedics to use their training and expertise in community-based non-emergency care roles, notably assisting extramural program members in performing routine checkups and follow-up visits with patients. Those links don't exist right now because all three services are managed separately. The New Brunswick extramural staff want nothing more than to see New Brunswickers to continue to receive the best possible healthcare services in a timely manner in the comfort of their home. And tonight, I can tell you that I truly believe by integrating the services of extramural program, Ambulance New Brunswick, and Telecare 821, we will